Hey guys, what is up? John here from flyatmikealpha.com, here today with Jessica Veruda, who is a private pilot working on instrument. And you guys probably already follow her on Instagram. If you don't, then you should. And today we're going to learn all about how she became a private pilot, all the cost it took, how much time it took, and all those steps and what she was doing with her life, basically, well, she became a pilot.
Sure.
So Jessica, when did you first decide you wanted to be a pilot?
Aviation was really kind of a fixture in my life, not from the standpoint of some kids growing up where their parents have planes or their family has a plane and they have direct access to aviation, but I actually grew up in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, so
pretty big aviation town.
No better place to discover airplanes of all types, all shapes and sizes, and every aviator in the world knows Oshkosh, so starting here was just, it was perfect.
And that's where we're here today, is Oshkosh 2019. The show is in full swing, so it's a little loud, that's why.
Yep. And we're standing in front of this beautiful Waco 1934 YKC model, and it's is a immaculate restoration show grand champion, and it's not mine, I wish it was. I plan to own one someday.
Maybe winning a lottery, something like that.
Or doing a restoration job.
So how many years ago then did you really decide, I want to be a pilot? When did you really make that decision in your life?
Well, I made the decision to become a pilot when I was a young child sitting in my bedroom. Oshkosh was in my backyard. I see the Concorde fly over my house, B-2s, B-1 bombers, everything you can imagine for the rare aircraft around the world that has shown up to Oshkosh over the years. And I'd watch from my backyard or outside the fence at EAA before I started to attend the event. Mm-hmm. And I would sit in my bedroom in a chair with a box fan and a broomstick and put on these old headphones and
pretend to be a pilot.
You know, I'd start up the engine with low speed and then I'd go up to medium and high for the takeoff, and I'd lean back in the chair, and it was just always a fantasy to become a real pilot. And
so how many years ago did you decide, okay, like I'm actually gonna go for it? When did you take that first step to start studying and taking lessons?
The first real step was in late 2004.
Okay.
After I had graduated high school, I decided it's time. I already took a ground school course in senior year of high school.
Okay.
And I was a huge avid flight simmer for probably 8 years, ever since Flight Sim 98. And did all that stuff. So I had thousands of hours of flight sim with the yoke and the rudder pedals, and I felt like I already had a leg up on the training. And I took the plunge in 2004, late 2004, going into winter, and I started my flight training. The instructor had to tell me, look outside the airplane, look out the window, because I was fixated on the instruments, because the early flight simulators didn't have a lot for outside visuals when you're looking at it. So I learned how to fly instruments and doing ILS approaches and following VORs. And then I started out in 172s, various models, and I looked out the window and racked up about 12 or 13 hours before I stopped that leg of the training.
Yeah, and so through 2004, then you hit that little pause. Mm-hmm. And when did you resume your training?
Sure. Actually, the reason for the pause was doing my flight training very early in the morning with an empty stomach. And I don't usually recommend that anymore from my own experience, because it's an easy way to get motion sickness issues or get disoriented when you're doing the special maneuvers, because it messes with your head. And if you're not a flyer and you're not used to it and you're susceptible to motion sickness, you're going to run into problems. Yeah. And I was doing maneuvers like steep turns and unusual attitude recovery, and I would just find myself getting sick. And I ended up deciding, I'm not going to finish right now. I had a love for music. You can see the tattoo on my arm. And playing music professionally was another goal of mine, and I decided to just put my flying on hiatus and play music instead.
And there's a number of students I've had over the years that were susceptible to motion sickness, and usually we start them off with Dramamine, work them down to ginger gum, and then over time, after exposure to it, and after, you know, maybe 10, 15, 20 hours of flying, you get used to it.
Sure.
So when did you finally decide to resume it?
I think around 2015, 2015, 2016. In 2015, I visited a friend who actually met at EAA and through Instagram, real similar to John and I.
Yeah.
And we were working for EAA Photo here at AirVenture. And I ended up going to San Francisco to visit him.
Yeah.
He lived outside San Francisco, and we did a Bay Tour flight in a 172 with he and his instructor. And we flew over the Golden Gate Bridge and Alcatraz Island and all of the beautiful scenery out there. He flew one leg, I sat in the back and filmed and took photographs, and then it was my turn, and I got back in the left seat, and it really just kind of kicked it back off.
Mm-hmm.
And back in Wisconsin, I resumed my flight training, not this time in 172s, but actually J3 Cubs, and I started flying Tailwheel. And so you go back to the vintage aircraft and the Tailwheel flying and real stick and rudder flying, and you're back to the basics. And just a really neat way to learn how to fly.
Yeah, so 2015, you already had, about 15 hours prior?
Yeah,
but that was 10 years ago.
Yeah, I was very close to soloing.
Yeah.
And when I did my initial training, it was here in Oshkosh at Whitman Regional Airport, and it's tower controlled airport. And I never got myself really proficient with radio calls, and that seemed to be the only thing that was holding me back because of being intimidated by controllers.
Yeah, they're actually nice folks.
They are. They're that's right. And I've learned that since then.
Yeah.
But that was a reason for me not to feel comfortable enough to continue the intimidation and the motion sickness that I was experiencing. But when I started again, it was with J3 Cubs in Hartford, Wisconsin at Cub Air Flight. Steve Krog is one of the premier tailwheel flight instructors in the Midwest. They've multiple times hosted the gathering of J3 Cubs that come to Oshkosh. They did the 75th anniversary, and I helped organize the 80th anniversary. But that was an uncontrolled airport, tailwheel flying, stick and rudder, real
basic.
And it's just
an easy way to really accelerate your training and excel through there.
And
so how long, from 2015, how long was it? How many months did it take to hit basically where you're ready for a check ride?
I believe, my check ride actually came the following year.
Okay.
In 2016, but 2015 was my my 30th birthday, and I took my first solo
on
my 30th birthday, which was just
pretty good way to spend it.
You know, normally students will do it at their 16th birthday, and that's
incredible.
That's what they do. But you know, for me, I took a lot of time off, and then I came back, and the 30th birthday, on my birthday, it felt just as cool as if it would have been happening at
16. Your first solo is always super cool, no matter what age it is. Never too late, never too early.
Sure. So my training kind of progressed, and it went in a different direction. I had my solo, and I flew J3 Cubs quite a bit, but then I ended up moving to Kansas to work for a light sport aircraft manufacturer out there. And working for the company, I was doing marketing, and I got into doing light avionics installs. Well, I shouldn't say light, because I installed an entire Garmin G3X setup in one of their builds for the factory aircraft. But I had access to fly the S19 model that this company has, and fly to Sun and Fun and fly to Oshkosh. But I was still a student in Sun and Fun, and I had a 20-hour solo cross country over 4 days. And By the time I was ready to take my check ride, it was already at around 100 hours.
Yeah, so about 100 hours into it, how much would you say out-of-pocket costs? The way from 2004 all the way through 2016, total out-of-pocket cost.
I've been very fortunate that much of it was not my money or being able to fly for the company or trade marketing and multimedia social media services with Cub Air Flight in Hartford with the J3 Cubs at.
Yeah.
Very little of my flight training did I actually have to pay for.
Yeah.
And everybody's got to know that there is that option.
There is avenues,
There are various
kind
avenues.
Of offset the cost, So say maybe $1,000,
$2,000. Oh, thousands, given how much I flew.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's friends. You can go out to the airport. You can start washing planes. You can get the bugs off of them. You can hang out, just be... You're not even annoying, because pilots love to talk airplanes.
Yeah, they love to take people flying. You could sweep the hangar floor, like you said, wash airplanes, do any number of things to find some free flight time.
Yeah.
And you can get it done pretty cheap. I mean, typical private pilot, $8,000 to $12,000.
Sure.
It can be done a lot less.
Yeah.
And so 2015 to check ride, how many months was that from when you resumed until your check ride date?
It was probably about 10 months.
Okay, about 10 months.
10 months that I gained maybe 50, 60 hours.
Yeah, and lucky enough to kind of work in aviation here and there during that time.
Sure.
Which really helped offset some of that cost and everything.
Absolutely.
Awesome. So, cool. Well, what would you say would be the number one thing to help somebody get through fast and cheap? You know, so saving time, saving money. What's the most important things?
Find somewhere that is not going to be overly expensive. There are a lot of flight schools out there with total glass panel aircraft, and their rental pricing is not cheap. It's not going to be your best option to rentals for flight training. As a private pilot or instrument pilot, that type of aircraft is perfectly fine for you, but you're not going to save any money by going with the fancy dancy 172s or 182s.
Basic J3 Cub, no electrical system, really cheap to rent because it's just as good.
Sure.
Get the same license.
Yep, you can rent them for around $80 an hour, which is on the low end of any of the aircraft rentals you can get, and an instructor is generally around $60-$65. And you'd be looking at $150 or less an hour. And even in 2004, it was a little less. It was about $105 an hour with the instructor. But times are changing. Gas is getting more expensive.
Yeah.
And you got to find other ways to do it. But accelerate your training is to take the initiative.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, learn the materials. Grab the books. Yeah, get all the groundwork done. Join in with other ground schools.
Yeah, try to get your ground school done before you get in the airplane.
Yes, I didn't do that, but I've learned through working for flight schools and a maintenance shop that I worked for previously that get your writtens done, your ground school done out of the way, because then you can focus on training. Whereas me, I never took my written until right before I took my Checkride, and I crammed for a week straight. And I got about 90, but when I had the oral portion of my Checkride test, I was sweating bullets and I didn't think I knew anything.
Yeah.
Because a lot of it's memorization, so, but you really need to know
the stuff. You need to be able to apply the material,
That's right.
Not just memorize it, but also apply it and really think with it. What would you say was the biggest thing to overcome? Was it the motion sickness? Or what was the hardest thing you had to overcome in flight training?
I think the motion sickness initially was the hardest thing I had to overcome. And I did in the end. And the more you fly, the less you're affected by it.
Yeah.
As long as you're PIC, if you're a passenger, it's possible you're still going to be susceptible to it.
When you get your hands on the controls, it's a little easier.
Yeah, especially if you're in a really hot airframe.
Yep.
The sun's beating down on you. There isn't a lot of cool air coming at you. But if you are in control, you're focused, you're having a good time, you're having a blast. And I haven't really gotten sick more than once as PIC.
Awesome. Well, I think to sum it up, basically work in aviation. It'll cut down the cost of your training.
Yeah, in or around.
Yep. If you are getting a little motion sick, not a big deal. Take some mitigating steps, you know, ginger gum, Dramamine. When you're in training as a pilot, you can't really use Dramamine, but you can always use ginger gum even as a pilot.
Sure.
It's FAA approved.
Yeah, and they make ginger pills that you can take. They make silly little things you can put behind your ears or on your wrists that some people swear by. They didn't work for me, but there are a lot of options
out there.
There's
a lot of ways to kind of mitigate that.
Cut down.
You can work through it, and in time, you become a little desensitized to some of that.
You do.
And no matter what, stick with it. Never too late. You still got into it fairly early, soloing 30th birthday.
That's right.
And whether you're solo 30th birthday,
or your 60th or 70th,
it's still super cool. So hopefully hearing Jessica's story kind of gives you guys an idea of how she made it into aviation, how she became a private pilot, hopefully how you could become a private pilot. Or there's so many other videos we will link in the description below of stories of how others became private pilots, the steps they went through, how long it took them, how much it cost, and what steps they took to be successful in aviation. So thank you so much for taking
the
time.
You're welcome. Thank you for
We've got an air show to go watch. So
we're
going to go do that.
We absolutely do. We're going to do that.
It's really cool.
See ya.